In this lesson, we will focus our attention on understanding appropriate constructs, resources, and policies and issues that go into implementing and utilizing mass storage systems. So specifically, we will focus on understanding disk space allocation policies, highlight appropriate figures of merit that can influence those policies, provide an overview of the Unix file system. And we'll note that there are going to be similarities in regards to these allocation policies as it relates to memory management as well. So for example, let's consider the namespaces and physical entities that we associate with memory and file systems. For virtual memory, we have a virtual address space, but correspondingly for file systems, we have a file name. And for physical entities, we have a physical memory block that is used to store our data. And for file systems, we'll discuss a disk block. So this helps us to understand the role and mechanisms that enable file systems to integrate and store information necessary in our computer systems. And so when we think about a file system, of course, we can always think of it in the abstract manner, just like a physical filing cabinet. When in each of the files, we'll have a collection of information that we use to store that is associated with a specific data entity. We have specific ways in which we're able to work with file systems. And so in the past, we've explored how process is a part of software abstraction for processors, and then data structures are a part of software abstractions for memory. So in this sense, we'll explore file as being a software abstraction for an input and output device, since the devices can provide for sources of information that we need to utilize. So there are various file allocation schemes that can be utilized. We have a contiguous allocation, contiguous allocation with overflow, linked function, linked allocation, we have our file allocation table, we have indexed allocation, we have multi-level indexed, and we have hybrid indexed. You want to take into consideration that this functionality is going to be similar to memory management, and it's implemented by a storage manager or a file system that's part of our operating system. It's important to note that most operating systems are going to support more than one file system. Some appropriate figures of merit that we need to take into consideration. We want to ensure fast sequential access, fast random access, the ability to grow the file, easy allocation of storage, and efficiency of space utilization on the disk. And so we'll consider appropriate use cases for fast sequential access. We want flexibility, time, and efficiency relates to concerns in regards to internal and external fragmentation as it relates to memory. So with fast sequential access and fast random access, this is going to be specific to the file system, while our latter concerns are going to be related to the virtual memory and file system. And so we can consider contiguous allocation. This is very similar to a variable size partitioning that can be done. And so when working with a contiguous allocation, we'll also make use of a free list as well. And so when we have our file system that contains a free list, it's going to represent the available blocks that can be used. And so we want to think of a free list as a data structure that can be used to keep track of any file disk blocks that are not being used or that are not allocated. So this will be a data structure in our storage manager for us to use. And it's represented on disk, but we cache it in physical memory. And so we have this represented as an appropriate data structure that we can use that can represent the file name. And then for each file name, we have an associate starting address. And then we also have our free list of disk blocks. So this will be similar to techniques that we use for memory management. But you want to consider, again, this is on disk, but it's cached in memory. And so with contiguous allocation, let's compare it with appropriate metrics. Does it support growth? No. Quickness of allocation? Well, it has similar issues to variable size partition memory management. So you can use first fit, best fit, compaction. Fragmentation occurs both internally and externally, but contiguous allocation does support sequential access and random access. So in order to fix this, we can have contiguous allocation with appropriate overflows included. Next, we can turn our attention to understanding linked file allocation, linked list allocations. And so here we have our linked list allocation and how it is represented. And we want to keep in mind that in utilizing this type of scheme, that we're going to be allowing for the file system to allocate in the individual disk blocks, but we maintain our free list still. And the free list can actually be a linked list to represent the various sectors that are going to be utilized. And so we can represent the linked list by using multiple disk blocks that can represent a traversal based on our freely available blocks. So when we physically want to think about our linked allocation, we can have our free list in memory too. That's going to link to appropriate free blocks that are in our file system as well. And so in some cases, we can have specific blocks that are going to be utilized to represent various files that we have stored. And then we have our free list that is also represented in memory. And one benefit of this is that it does allow for quick allocation to occur. It minimizes external fragmentation because it's allowing for an on-demand allocation. And again, the data structures are on disk, but they're cached in memory. So when we compare linked list allocation against our metrics, it does allow for growth. It has quickness of allocation time. It minimizes external fragmentation. It allows for sequential access, but not necessarily random access because it's dependent on the seek time. So now we can focus our attention on FAT or file allocation tables. And so when we first want to think about how our block addresses are represented, and we have logical block addresses. So essentially we're going to adopt a convention of converting cylinder track sectors into a logical block address. So in doing so with this, we calculate an integer from 0 to n minus 1, and then we use that value so that the disk appears to be a simple array of disk sectors or blocks. Most modern disk controllers present this abstraction to the CPU to prevent it from having to know the geometry of the physical disk drives. And so when we talk about disk block addresses, we've glossed over the specific nomenclature, but we want to keep in mind that we used ordered triples in the past to represent the cylinder number, head number, and block number as an address in order to keep the performance optimized. In modern times, we've been able to add intelligent disk controllers that do the scheduling for us, as well as zone recording schemes on the disks to pack more data. This makes the addressing from the 1950s hard to calculate without a significant table of data that relates specifically to the hard disk model being used. So in order to solve this problem, what we're going to do is allow for the addressing of the disk blocks to be done as an array from 0 to n minus 1. And we're letting the controller and the drive do the optimization. And so most modern hard drive protocols, SATA, SAS, NVM, will use cylinder, head, and block notation. But it's not sent as a simple integer from 0 to the number of blocks on the device, or is sent as a simple integer. So in representing a file allocation table, we want to keep in mind that this is similar to a linked allocation. We have our file allocation table on disk, and it contains linked lists to the files that are currently being used on the disk. So we do have our index, which is going to correspond to our logical block address. We have our array that is representing the linked list. And of course, the structure is on disk, but cached in memory. And so in comparing file allocation tables, we focus on, does it allow for growth, quickness of allocation, fragmentation, sequential access, random access. It's less error prone. And partitioning is done, so it keeps that from the user perspective. So now we focus our attention on indexed allocation. And so we want to keep in mind some specific terminology related to Unix. Unix separately stores the metadata for a file in a novel way. And this technique has been used in a number of subsequent file systems, but Unix terminology is often used to describe it. And first we'll have our inode. Inode is all of the information about a file except name was stored in a fixed length entry on the disk called an inode. And inodes are kept in an array on the file system. So the disk location of an inode could be calculated from its index, often called the inumber. Inodes can be cached by the OS in memory when a file is in use. Directories contain only the file names and the inumber. The inode index number corresponds to the inumber. And it's possible for two directory entries to contain the same inumber. So when we have our index allocation, we're allocating specific disk blocks that are indexed for each file. And for each index block, we'll have a fixed size data structure that contains the appropriate addresses for the data blocks that are a part of that file. So here we have our inode, our index node or inode, which occupies the disk block and the corresponding data blocks that it's associated with. Then we have our directory that contains the file name to the index node mapping. So in this case, inode will hold M entries. So our max file size is going to be M blocks. And so it's important to note that this scheme is similar to linked allocation, and it's going to maintain a free list as a bit vector of disk blocks. And in that, it's going to have 0 for free and 1 for busy. And so when we're considering index allocation, what factors does it allow for us to focus on? Growth, it results in problems. We have quickness of allocation time. Fragmentation is good. It has the same sequential access as our FAT, and random access, again, it's same as our file allocation table. Next, we can focus our attention on multi-level index and hybrid indexing. So in multi-level indexing, this allows for us to make use of M entries in our inode with N levels of indexing. And so this allows for a scheme that allows for us to expand on just one level of indirection. So with this, we can have pointers for our first level indirection index blocks. And so with the, in this case, for our inode, we have two or higher indirection tables that are utilized. And these are going to represent the size of the files that are supported by our file system. So we can have a max of M to N blocks in a file. This represents our initial allocation. And then as the file grows, we have different levels that are also incorporated and additional blocks that are linked as well. This takes multiple levels of indirection to get our required data blocks that are needed. So this provides for a different approach, but it does have a downside in that it can take additional time for even just a small file to have to grow in multiple directions. So let's consider with different file sizes for our multi-level index allocation. It's going to result in some problem for small files, as we just discussed, because the index blocks take up as much or more space than the file. And so this is where we introduce another index allocation called hybrid allocation. So in hybrid allocation, what we focus on is providing an inode for every file, and it's going to accommodate the data blocks for a small file with direct pointers. But then we can also have appropriate pointers to represent single indirect as well as double and triple indirect. So with utilizing this scheme, what happens is when we create a file, only the inode is allocated, and then it's determined if the single, double, and triple indirect pointers are assigned or initially will be null. So as the file size grows, it doesn't exceed the amount of space available. Appropriate pointer is utilized to allocate additional index blocks. So the benefit of this is, in this case, if the file continues to grow and it exceeds the size of the direct data blocks, then you can allocate additional blocks at the first level index or second and third level indexes as well. So let's consider the benefits of our multi-level indexed allocation. It allows for growth, allows for quickness of allocation, fragmentation is conserved, sequential access is the same as our fixed allocation table, and random access is the same as our file allocation table as well. So overall, when we discuss the various file allocation policies that can use, this provides us with a high-level overview of each one. And so we can see where contiguous allocation falls short with regards to free list maintenance, file growth, overhead allocation, allocation overhead and space efficiency. And then we can see where contiguous with overflow falls short, but still improves on contiguous, as well as comparing linked lists, file allocation table, indexed, multi-level indexed, and hybrid indexed. So these provide an overview of some of the different allocation strategies that can be utilized. And some things that you want to consider when comparing our file access table, our file allocation table, and our multi-level indexed allocation is that partitioning isn't good for FAT, and multi-level indexing is not good for small files. So now let's consider an example in which we are given the following. We have a size of index blocks, a size of index block 512 bytes. We have a size of data blocks 2048 bytes. Size of our pointer is 8 bytes. The inode consists of 2 direct data block pointers, 1 single indirect pointer, and 1 double indirect pointer. And in this index block is used for the inode as well as for the index blocks that store pointers to other index blocks and data blocks. Note that the index block and data blocks are allocated on a need basis. What is the maximum size and bytes of a file that can be stored in this file system? How many data blocks are needed for storing the same data file of 266 kilobytes? And how many index blocks are needed for storing a data file of 266 kilobytes? So if we want to work out this example, we want to consider the maximum size of the file. It's going to be the index block can hold 512 divided by 8, 64 entries with 2 blocks in inode. So that's 64 entries in the first level index, 64 times 64 entries in the second level index, a total of 4,162 blocks times 2,048 bytes. And so the number of data blocks to hold 266 kilobytes, we have 266 times 2 to the 10 divided by 2048 equals 266 divided by 2 equals 133 blocks. And so how many indirect blocks to hold 266 kilobytes? 2 direct plus 64 first level blocks plus 64 plus 3 second level blocks, 1 inode plus 1 first level index plus 1 plus 2 second level indexes. And so that is what it's going to take to hold our index blocks for 266 kilobytes. So if we think about it this way, when it comes to the Unix operating system, we make use of a hybrid allocation, and it has hierarchical naming that it can occur. And so here we have our inode field to identify this node as a directory or if it's going to be a data file. And within the inode, it'll include appropriate mechanism to determine if it's going to, how many blocks will be represented. If it's a single indirect pointer, then we have 64 data blocks that are utilized. And for double, we have 64 times 2 that can be utilized. And this can correspond to 3 additional data blocks utilized. And then we can have appropriate pointers to all five of our index blocks. So we can focus our attention on understanding how the Unix file system allocates files and directories. And so you'll have appropriate attributes that are going to be utilized in a hierarchical manner. And so each component is represented as you'll have a name, you'll have your type, and you'll have access rights, and then the dates that are associated with those attributes to whether it's a file or a directory. And you can have specific operations that can be applied to the files, such as open, read, write, close, link and unlink, rename, move, or change the access mode. So let's say you have a directory that contains various files and other directories. So in this case, we have each node in the tree is going to represent a name. And so we have users, we have students, staff, and faculty. And so a name can be a file or it could be a directory. And so in the structure that we have shown here, we can apply appropriate commands to each directory. So if we wanted to apply read, write, this data can be stored in our metadata for the inode. And then we can apply appropriate access rights for the user, the group, and other. So the user has read rights and the group and other just have read access. We can apply any links that are needed. And the link is going to represent the username of the user. We can apply which group is going to be used. And in this case, the group is represented as the faculty. And then we have the size of our file as well. The date represented represents the modification date. Then we have our name in the directory. And so you'll have a D represented if it's a directory. So links in Unix file systems, the directory entry is separated from the inode. So this will mean that more than one directory entry can index the same inode. So when you create a file, you can initialize an inode and create a directory entry. This sets the link count in the inode to be one. You can also create additional links to the file with the link system call, or ln command. This increments the link count in the inode for each link, and this is called a hard link. There is no such thing as a primary or secondary link. Both directory entries are names for the file, and neither link has precedence over the other. So there is no system call to remove a file. You can only unlink a directory entry. The file is deleted from the file system only when its link count reaches zero. You remove a link with the unlink system call or the rm command. Each inode also has an in-use count, which counts the number of processes that have the file open. The inode is not deallocated until the link count and the in-use count both reach zero. So we're also able to provide for file aliases called symbolic links. A symbolic link will occupy an inode, and the inode is marked as a symbolic link. The data blocks contain a path name instead of the user data. So when a symbolic link is encountered while following a path name, the path is replaced by the contents of the symbolic link, and the search continues by following the path in the symbolic link. The file system doesn't promise that symbolic links point to anything. The presence of a symbolic link pointing to a file name doesn't prevent that file from being unlinked. Symlinks work across file systems, contrasted with hard links that do not. So here, if we have a directory entry, it only contains the name and the I number. And so we can have this pointing to another directory that is a link. So this is just another directory entry that points to the same. And so if you call ln, that will link to the existing file or directory. And in order to remove the link, you have to call rm to remove. So this provides an overview of appropriate attributes associated with file system components. So we have our alias, the owner, creation time, last write time, appropriate privileges, size, etc. Then we have appropriate unit commands that can be utilized as well. You just want to keep in mind that directories are files that users can't write. So in this case, our inode for users is going to be our block 291 is going to have the faculty, staff, and students file name with appropriate inode addresses. Which is then linked to users faculty, which has other file names. So this provides a hierarchy of how directories are accessed. The integrity of file systems is another point to keep in mind. File systems can sometimes corrupt and cause a system crash. So when this happens, some of the cache blocks may not get written out. Metadata on disk can be inconsistent. The free space list is inconsistent, and subsequent allocations may write over good data. This can require some extensive time-consuming consistency checks, but many modern file systems are able to avoid this situation. Journaling can be used as a way to write metadata changes before committing them to the file system. So replaying the last few minutes of journaling is much faster than doing a full consistency check. So journaling doesn't necessarily guarantee user data is consistent. Some blocks may get written out of order. Most modern file systems use a copy-on-write model. And this means that data blocks are never rewritten, but copied to free space. blocks are rewritten in an order that guarantees that the disk file system is always consistent. So there's no need for consistency checking. Some examples that follow this approach for copy on write include ZFS and BTRFS. Simple hybrid index file system can also be used. And in this case, we are provided with two files, fs.h and fs.c. Between the two files is an implementation of a small hybrid index file system. Our file system divides the disks into blocks of size, block size, and each block can be one of four types: an inode, an index block, a data block, and a free block. Each of these types has a corresponding strut definition in fs.h. So some simple characteristics: our inodes have number direct blocks that are representing direct data pointers. We have one single indirect data pointer, and both the direct data pointers and the indirect data pointers are stored in the inode as their block numbers. Even though these types of file systems have directories for naming files, the small implementation doesn't include them to make it more approachable. Appropriate functions you want to consider are main, fs read and fs write, disk read and disk write as well. And this provides an overview of how a hybrid index example could work.